Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, WFIRST is go! Astronomers identify and characterize the most distant galaxy cluster found yet, and a new black hole telescope sees first light. Have you ever wondered how astronomers decide what space telescopes to build, or any telescope for that matter? Well, each decade, astronomers gather to discuss the most important questions they'd like to try and answer about the universe, and then they rank them. Now, you can imagine that these meetings are pretty fractious, but in the end, they usually result in some list that ranks what they find most important. Once they have that list, they look at what telescopes they'd like to build to help answer those questions. Now again, I'm sure there's lots of quiet, rational, congenial discussions that ensue. But again, they usually succeed in providing a list, and the corresponding report that comes out is commonly called the Decadal Survey by astronomers. Now, one big goal of the Decadal Survey is to give policymakers and decision makers something to go on when deciding what to fund. NASA's Science Directorate, for example, uses it heavily in deciding what spacecraft it wants to build. Now, since these surveys come out every 10 years, the last one came out in 2010, and, well, envelope please! Astronomers chose the Wide Field Infrared Survey Telescope as its number one instrument it would like to see built. Now, just so you know, the previous decadal survey listed the James Webb Space Telescope as number one, and it's being built now, so you can see the kind of influence this report has. WFIRST will use one of two Hubble Space Telescope-like chassis that was given to NASA by the National Reconnaissance Office back in 2012, and while it's Hubble-sized and has the same size primary as Hubble, that's where the similarities between WFIRST and Hubble will end. As its name implies, it will be a wide-field telescope and see a much larger portion of the sky than Hubble can. Way more. So here's an example of what I'm talking about. This animated GIF shows just how many pointings of the Hubble Space Telescope it took to build this mosaic of a portion of the Andromeda Galaxy known as FAT. It took 432 pointings to cover this much of M31. But WFIRST can cover the same ground in just two pointings. So why do astronomers want WFIRST? WFIRST is intended to settle essential questions in the area of dark energy, exoplanets, and infrared astrophysics. The wide field camera will have a field of view that is 100 times greater than the Hubble wide field camera, capturing more of the sky with less observing time. As the primary instrument, the wide field camera will measure light from 380 million galaxies over the course of the mission lifetime. The coronagraph instrument will capture light from about 2,600 exoplanets over the course of the mission. Now, where Hubble has found only a few galaxies within 500 million years of the Big Bang, we now know, from Hubble, that WFIRST will find hundreds of these rare objects. In addition, the WFIRST coronagraph will be a much better planet-hunting telescope than Hubble, and will allow direct imaging of ice and gas giant exoplanets by blocking out the host star's light. So last week, Paul Hertz, the director of NASA's Astrophysics Division, told astronomers attending the American Astronomical Society meeting last week that the project will enter its formulation phase, which is the beginning of NASA's project management process, in February. This coming after the proposed space telescope passed a mission concept review back in December. That decision also comes after the passage of the fiscal year 2016 omnibus spending bill in December that provided $90 million for WFIRST, which was far above NASA's request of $14 million. The report accompanying the bill adopted language that was approved by Senate appropriators in June, directing NASA to move WFIRST into the formulation phase by early 2016. So what this means now is astronomers have to get to work finishing the design of the mission and set its goals, work on instruments, as well as get ready for launch sometime in the next decade. WFIRST is designed for a 6-year mission and will launch on an evolved expendable launch vehicle, the ELV, right out of Cape Canaveral. Next, astronomers using NASA's Great Observatories have detected a massive, sprawling, churning galaxy cluster that formed only 3.8 billion years after the Big Bang, making this cluster the most distant one found yet. Galaxy clusters are conglomerations of hundreds to thousands of galaxies bound together by gravity. They are the most massive structures in the universe, and those located relatively nearby, such as the Virgo Cluster, are extremely bright and easy to spot in the sky. But finding galaxy clusters that are farther away in space and further back in time is a very difficult and time-consuming thing. The cluster, named IDCS-J1426.5 plus 3508, or, affectionately, just IDCS-1426, is the most massive cluster of galaxies yet discovered in the first 4 billion years after the Big Bang. Now, because of their sheer size, scientists think it should take several billion years for them to form. The distance of IDCS-1426 means astronomers are observing it when the universe was only 3.8 billion years old, implying that the cluster is seen at a very young age, and that this may be one of the earliest clusters to form in the universe. IDCS-1426 appears to be undergoing a substantial amount of upheaval. The researchers observed a bright knot of X-rays slightly off-center at the cluster, indicating that the cluster's core may have shifted some 100,000 light-years from its center. The scientists surmise that the core may have been dislodged from a violent collision with another massive galaxy cluster, causing the gas within the cluster to slosh around. To get a more precise estimate of the galaxy's mass, astronomers used data from several of NASA's great observatories, the Hubble Space Telescope, the Keck Observatory, and the Chandra X-ray Observatory. Both the Hubble and Keck observatories recorded optical data from the cluster, which the researchers analyzed to determine the amount of light that was bending around the cluster as a result of gravity, which was a phenomenon known as gravitational lensing. Now, you guys know about gravitational lensing, but the more massive the cluster, the more gravitational force it exerts, and the more light it bends. They also examined X-ray data from the Chandra Observatory to get a sense of the temperature of the cluster. High-temperature objects give off X-rays, and the hotter a galaxy cluster, the more the gas within that cluster has been compressed, making the cluster more massive. Now, from the X-ray data, they also calculated the amount of gas in the cluster, which can be an indication of the amount of matter, and therefore the mass, in the cluster. Using all three methods, the group calculated roughly the same mass, about 250 trillion with a T times the mass of the Sun. Now the team is looking for individual galaxies within the cluster to try and get a sense for how such megastructures can form in the early universe. The knowledge gained from these observations provides another much-needed piece of the puzzle that helps us understand how, when, and why galaxies and clusters formed in the early universe. Finally, a new ground-based instrument designed to look at black holes, among other things, sees first light. The new instrument on ESO's Very Large Telescope, known as Gravity, all caps, was turned on for the first time after spending the last 6 months or so being built. Gravity is an interferometer which is designed to see very small details on faint objects, like the centers of galaxies, extremely precisely. It combines the light from multiple telescopes to form a virtual telescope up to 200 meters across, using a technique which is called interferometry. This enables astronomers to detect much finer detail in astronomical objects than is possible with a single telescope. As part of the first observations, the team looked closely at the bright young stars known as the Trapezium Cluster, which is located in the heart of the Orion Nebula's star-forming region. Already, from these first commissioning data, Gravity made a small discovery. One of the components of the cluster was found to be a double star. Gravity can measure the positions of astronomical objects on the finest scales, and can also perform interferometric imaging and spectroscopy. Now, to give you an example of just how fine a scale it can look, if there were buildings on the moon, gravity would be able to spot them. Such extremely high-resolution imaging has many applications, but the main focus in the future will be studying the environments around black holes. In particular, gravity will probe what happens in the extremely strong gravitational field close to the event horizon of the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way, which explains the choice of the name of the instrument. This is a region where behavior is dominated by Einstein's theory of general relativity. In addition, it will uncover the details of mass accretion and jets, processes that occur both around newborn stars, young stellar objects, and in the regions around supermassive black holes at the centers of other galaxies. It will also excel at probing the motions of binary stars, exoplanets, and young stellar disks, as well as in the imaging of the surfaces of stars. So far, gravity has been tested with the four 1.8-meter auxiliary telescopes. The first observations using gravity with the four 8-meter VLT unit telescopes are planned for later in 2016. I'll keep you posted. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. Thank you all for watching. And as always, keep looking up.